BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
NAP Connection is a panel discussion on selected art and art issues with your guest and a host, Ron Schira. Home viewers are invited to call in during the live telecast and offer comments or questions of the artist. NAP Connection is brought to you by the New Arts Program, a nonprofit art service organization in cooperation with Berks Community Television. The New Arts Program is supported in part by the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, local government, businesses, NAP memberships, and individual contributions. Well, hello and welcome to NAP Connections. I am your host, Ron Schira, and we're going to be talking with a sculptor today, a sculptor and artist, a conceptual artist, somebody who uses his sculpture to create ideas. This is Charles Emlen, and he is Philadelphia, essentially. Where are you from?
Chester County.
Chester County?
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Willistown Township,
yep.
Paoli.
Pleasure to have you here.
Happy to be here.
Yep. And Charles is having a show at the present down in Phoenixville. At the Community Arts of Phoenixville.
That's
Center.
Correct, yeah, on Bridge Street.
On Bridge Street down there.
Bridge Street, yeah.
And we're going to be showing some of his artworks and talking with him about some of his processes and what he does. So, hi, welcome aboard. Welcome to the NAP Connections.
Nice to be here. Thanks for asking me.
Yeah, my pleasure. Tell us a little bit about yourself, Charles, your history, some of your reasons for making art, how you work.
Sure. well, like I said, I'm from. I grew up in Paoli, down in Willistown Township, and Chester County. Let's see. My father was a realtor. My mother was an artist. I probably got a bit from her. She was a painter, photographer.
Yeah,
and a lot of other interests, you know. But
usually happens that our parents influence us in many ways to be creative people.
Yes.
So I try to be creative. Like with my daughter, I try to be creative, but I don't try to influence her creativity.
Sure.
You know, just let the kids be who they are, and they will do it. Just like, no, don't do this, just do that. You know, but that's doesn't work like that. So tell us more.
I can claim the same experience, you know. I think my parents fostered my artistic tendency, but never tried to direct it.
Right.
I probably took, art classes when I was in high school and stuff like that. But I actually, when I went to college, it was not my intention to pursue a degree in the arts.
Oh, okay.
I tried a couple different things, and I wasn't doing that well. And I ended up in the sculpture studio up at Penn State.
Ah, okay.
And it turned out to be kind of where I belonged. So they had a great program there. They had a lot of visiting artists. They had a lot of different programs so that you could learn the different, the different materials that a sculptor might work in.
Mm-hmm.
Metal, stone, wood, figurative, So I went through a lot of that stuff there and kind of discovered what I was most comfortable with,
We seem very, very proficient in metal sculpture. You seem that seems to be your forte.
Yep, that was the thing that resonated the most when I did some of the metal work there. That's where I first started to weld. So in college at Penn State, and so after that I went out to Arizona, to ASU. That's where I got my master's degree. And it was mostly metal work out there.
Right.
A lot of concrete, and then I got into some mechanical art, electromechanical, kinetic work.
Which you have in your show down in Phoenixville.
Some of that is derivative of that.
Yeah.
But there's a couple slides that I'll show you that show some of the different work I did.
Uh-huh.
But so you know, that was back in the 80s, so that was a while ago.
Oh, but, okay.
Yeah.
Yeah, you wouldn't think you were that old, you know. But, you know, I know I am.
Yeah. Yeah.
But you also use mechanics, mechanical procedures in your work as well too, because some of the stuff has like hydraulics and balancing, flipping stuff. We have a video here which will show some of that.
Yes.
A little later here. So what are you trying to do with your sculpture? What is it that what are you aiming for?
That's a good question. I don't know that I necessarily have a particular thing that I'm aiming for, but you know, over the last 40 years, the common theme that's sort of developed is one of function and suggested utility.
Right.
I like to try and create a piece of art that has a suggested purpose. It has a feel like it's supposed to do something, but uh-huh. It never really does.
Right.
Sometimes there's lots of movement involved or sound or whatever, uh-huh. But yeah. The ultimate goal is just to sort of be there, just to be able to appreciate how it works, you know.
Mm-hmm.
So that's kind of what fascinates me. Mm-hmm. I, you know, I'm a maker and I like how things work.
Well, yeah, and to see the results of how of what you're doing, to see how it affects the audiences.
Mm-hmm.
So I do want to remind people that this is a live show right now, and that if you wish to call in, the telephone number here is 610-378-0426. So if you have any questions for Charles or myself, just give us a holler and we'll be happy to talk with you. So so right now, are you teaching, or are you living entirely on your art, or?
I am technically retired. I got laid off about 2 years ago, and I looked for a job for a little while, and then I said, the hell with it, I'm just gonna throw it all into the artwork. Mm-hmm. I've been going back and forth in and out of it for most of my life,
right,
and never fully committed myself to it. So about a year and a half ago, I decided to do just that.
Mm-hmm.
I still have some contracting work from the last place I worked, and I do software work for them.
Yeah,
and
yeah.
I can do that on my own time. But most of my days are consumed with some form of applying myself to doing artwork.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I might be in the studio working, or I might be chasing something down on the road, or perhaps online trying to get into a show or. Mm-hmm. You know, make some connection like that.
I do notice that a lot of your work has like certain sort of, like, what's the correct word for this? They have properties that apply to things like antennas and signaling.
Sure.
You know, that sort of stuff, because it seems that like a lot of the work has like directional screens and that sort of stuff, and we'll show some of that. Maybe we should start putting one or
sure,
two of them
can,
up.
You can do that. That's, you know, you'll see those later in the slides, but that's something that's sort of come out in the last 10, 15 years or so.
Oh, okay.
But it's just sort of a more recent manifestation of that idea of utility and function.
Okay. All right. Yeah, this first slide
okay.
is called what? What is this?
Dynamo.
Dynamo. Okay. Yeah, it has a kind of a... It looks like a dynamo. Looks like a power cell of some kind.
Yeah, it does have that appearance. This is from probably, you know, 1979, maybe. This is something I did when I was at Penn State, and mm-hmm. I was using a lot of large pieces of wood, timber, mm-hmm. and chainsaws to cut this stuff out. And so mm-hmm. this was sort of an idea of a very contemporary piece that sort of bridged the gap between sort of pre-colonial and early industrial machinery.
Mm-hmm. It has a post-industrial look to it, something that you know you might see in a power plant or something.
Right, and that's that was the suggestion.
That was the suggestion,
yeah.
Right? So that's wood, And
it was cut out. The one long section was cut right from a trunk of a tree,
uh-huh.
and I sort of made a mock-up lathe that I would turn manually, but used a chainsaw to cut it down, and then once I notched out the center and the two ends,
mm-hmm.
I wrapped them in steel. That's what the black is there,
uh-huh.
and then I built that cradle out of 2x6s, all bolted together, and set the thing in there. The thing still sits up in the Graduate Center at Penn State, up in the main campus. Yeah,
up on main campus.
Yes.
Okay. And
it's about six or seven feet long.
6 or 7 feet. It looks very labor intensive. I guess that was in your younger days when.
I still make the mistake of making pieces that seem too large to move, but over the years I've gotten pretty good at moving large things.
Mm-hmm.
I know where the balance, how to balance them properly. So,
you use cranes or just?
I don't need cranes, but usually some kind of forklift or something, but
mm-hmm.
not a forklift, but a hand truck.
Yeah, hand truck, yeah.
They're not massively heavy, but.
Heavy enough.
Heavy enough.
Yeah.
So this is from the same period. This piece is called Aggravation.
Okay.
And again, this was, cut out of a tree trunk, and then I kind of made this surrounding strap of steel around it, and then at the intersections of each of these three pieces, I put these large spikes into it.
Mm, okay, do you drive the spikes through the steel?
I actually, cut holes in the steel, but I did, I drove them into the wood.
Uh-huh.
I just had the fascination back then with the intersection between wood and metal and how well they work together. It always just looks so well to put mm-hmm. them together in different juxtaposition.
I don't know. I get a bondage sort of look out of
it. There's definitely a bondage. This is one of my mother's favorite pieces. She used to call it the Hangover.
The Hangover. Yeah, I saw that movie. It was really funny. Yeah, how big is this piece?
That piece is probably 4 feet tall. And it's long gone. I'm not sure whatever happened to that piece. But,
okay. Right. It's nice work.
So now we're into some of the work I did while I was at graduate school out at ASU.
Mm-hmm.
And I did a number of pieces with steel and concrete. I was just, I got kind of... hung up on that idea of how a lot of things out in the landscape are built in an industrial sense, with a concrete footer and rebar and reinforcement and steel appendages and all this stuff. So this piece is called Steamer, and it's obviously not a real steam shovel, but it has that suggestion of a steam shovel, but it's mm-hmm. just simply mounted on that large concrete pier. And that piece is about 5.5 feet tall.
So generally, all of these pieces are pretty large.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And as you can imagine, these concrete ones were the heaviest ones ever. And they were a bear to move. I was, like I said, I know I can move heavy things pretty easily, but I did sort of abuse my back over the years. And I'm tending towards lighter pieces these days.
Can't blame you there.
Yeah.
Yeah. These are earlier pieces then?
Yeah, this would be 1981 maybe.
81, okay.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And they're all very sort of formal and minimalistic. Like you've got these three parts to it. It has the concrete pedestal,
mm-hmm.
and then it has this simplified structural element connecting to the concrete, and that's bolted to rebar that's inside the concrete,
mm-hmm.
and the rebar is actually connected to that metal strip around the bottom. I kind of developed a method for doing these things so that they stood up well. Because
mm-hmm.
when I started casting concrete and I didn't have any metal on the bottom, the bottom of the concrete would always crack and crumble, when it got moved around.
Yeah.
So I developed this method of, I start at the base with metal angle iron, and then I weld reinforcement metal to that and bring it all the way up, and where the screws come out of the top, where that structural members bolted to it. That's all connected inside the concrete before I even poured the concrete inside the form.
So you made your the mold for this, and then you poured the concrete into it?
Yeah, exactly. Yep. So yeah, everything about all these sculptures is process oriented.
Oh, okay.
And it was a good deal. I spent a good deal of time creating the proper form so that when I poured mm-hmm. this thing, I didn't end up with a mess, you know.
So the scoop itself was manufactured entirely by you, or did you find that? Or?
No, I cut that out of quarter inch steel.
Wow.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, a lot of my work, people go, oh, where'd you find all these pieces? And for the most part, it's all manufactured.
It's all manufactured. So everything that we see here.
A lot of the pieces look like existing industrial components.
Yeah.
But they've all been created out of mostly flat steel and mm-hmm. you know, different types of metal.
Yeah, very interesting. So.
This is from about the same time. This is probably about 8 feet tall. And this mm-hmm. is sort of a play on the idea of a caution sign and a solar panel. It's called Solar Safety.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
This piece is actually still. I brought it east with me when I came back to Pennsylvania later, and it's still in my yard. I'm currently repainting those three panels, mm-hmm. and I'm taking it to a gallery down in Downingtown to put it outside there. So.
No, which gallery?
It's called Ivystone.
Ivystone?
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Never heard of it. We'll have to make sure people see that Ivystone. So,
this is still in Arizona, but a few years later, I stayed out there for about 7 years. After I got my graduate degree, I moved into the city and hung out with a bunch of other artists and did a lot of different work. So I did, for the period of about maybe 2 years, I was doing a lot of these sort of highly finished painted pieces. Kind of finished like you would finish an automobile.
I was just going to say, is that an automobile paint?
Yeah. So all the volumes on there are hollow. They're uh-huh. fabricated out of eighth inch sheet, and then welded together on the corners. And you grind all the corners off. And then I went to great lengths to just do a really good job to get the finish just right.
Mm-hmm.
But it was really worth it, because frequently the first time you go to move the piece, or you let someone else move it.
Uh-huh.
The paint would get chipped, and they became far too precious. So I kind of grew out of that phase pretty quickly. I probably made about maybe 20 pieces like that, mm-hmm. and there's still a few of them around down in Arizona. But this was one of my favorites, so I just showed one of them. But there are, every image that I show you, there are at least a dozen others like it from that same period of time.
Oh, okay. So we're looking at just a sampling of your different...
These are just samples of different styles, basically, yeah. Mm-hmm. Things that I've done through the years.
Mm-hmm. So, let's see.
And I don't know that piece ever had a name, but Mr. Frost of Frost Construction liked it.
Oh, okay. So
there was a commission. It's sitting out in front of this guy's business.
Okay, that says Schultz. Okay, and Associates underneath that, and Frost. Oh, but Frost is who you did it for.
Yes.
Okay, yeah. Okay. And that's in front of their business.
Yep. That's in Tempe, Arizona.
Tempe.
So, I had moved into Phoenix, into South Phoenix, with a couple other artists in an old warehouse.
Yeah.
And it was a great experience for a young artist. It was a combination gallery, music venue, performance space, whatever. It was just an interesting kind of bohemian scene.
Oh yeah.
And we had these machine performances there. There was lots of live music, lots of sculpture. I had my studio in the building, and I got, at that time I was inspired by a group of artists in San Francisco called the Survival Research Laboratories.
What was it called again? I'm sorry?
Survival Research Laboratories.
Survival Research, okay.
SRL.
Okay.
And they're still around today. A guy named Mark Pauline started the group, and they would create these semi-robotic contraptions and have these, they would stage these mock battles between these things, and they would generally tear each other apart. You've seen a lot of stuff on TV over the years,
right,
that kind
right,
of stuff.
Yeah,
these were the guys that created that whole...
Where Dwayne Johnson gets in there, and he directs the...
Oh, that's
he's
sure,
okay,
yeah.
Crash together, and these robots, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's funny.
So these guys predated all that stuff that you've seen on TV.
Mm-hmm.
So the guy that I was living there with was tied in with these guys, so we did a little bit of our own, and this is from a performance we had at that space in South Phoenix one time.
Uh-huh.
It's called Air Dog, and it is a walking contraption. It's mostly controlled by pneumatics.
Uh-huh.
There are several pneumatic cylinders on it, and there's a couple motors, and that little contraption in the back there, you can sort of see where it has feet.
Yeah.
It actually walks and pushes itself on the front there, and then the arm can lift up and down, and it can pick something up or whatever, but...
Mm-hmm. Well, that took some engineering, though, didn't it?
It did. Yes. And I did it. It was all ad hoc. I just, you know, I wanted to make something. I started building it, and I just experimented. And over the course of about 6 months, I got to a place where this thing actually worked. And it was pretty, pretty cool little machine.
Yeah, that's an unexplored area of art and science is robotics. Yeah.
Well, I mean, maybe it's not as well known, but there are a lot of people today working right in that same venue, you know, mm-hmm. that same vein. I mean, yeah.
Right. Right.
But.
Mm-hmm. So the lights up top, that's part of the gallery, that's not part of the device.
That's actually part of another device in the same. This was sort of on a raised stage, and there were several other things. You can see the flame kind of coming in from the side there. There was a flamethrower, and
oh my.
There were a number of things that were going on. This was just a photograph of part of it, so.
Mm-hmm.
But So that was an abbreviated look of what was going on out in Arizona in the 80s. And now this is in Pennsylvania. I don't know, this is sometime in the 90s. I'm not exactly sure when, but the piece is called Industrial Asteroid. And what it is a truncated, stellated dodecahedron.
Yeah, I was wondering.
So if you're familiar with your platonic solids, the cube, the tetrahedron, the octahedron, mm-hmm. the dodecahedron and the icosahedron. You can't really see it, but at the core of this is a dodecahedron. It's 12 faces, and each face has 5 sides.
Mm-hmm.
So each one of those pieces that are extending out from the center is an extrusion of a 12-sided or of a 5-sided pentagon.
Oh, I see. So this is very.
You can't see the dodecahedron, but it's there.
The
base of each of those pieces is the face, is one of the 12 faces.
So it's a dodecahedron, but it's like extended. So it's like
it's a stellated, truncated dodecahedron. So the stellation is the piece that comes out, and if you notice, each of the members are shortened at a different location. They're chopped off. They're truncated.
I see. Okay, that's interesting. I like the.
So it was really fun making that because you had to be very precise, you know, to get it all to fit together. You know, mm-hmm. I had 12 different elements, and you can't cut corners.
No, you can't cut corners because it's too precise. It's very precision oriented.
So when I put that last piece on, I was like, okay, I did it right. It worked out.
Mm-hmm. So you studied geometry, I imagine.
I didn't study it so much, but I've just always been very tuned into it.
Fascinating.
So I'm always paying attention to it, and there's a lot of geometry in my mm-hmm. work. So this was a commission. This is down in Chester Springs.
I was just going to ask you that. Where is it now?
It's in someone's yard uh-huh. down there.
Well, I really like that. It kind of looks like a three-dimensional asterisk in a way, you know? But I don't know.
It's very three-dimensional, yeah.
Yeah, very, very much.
So this is a few years later. This is this is more typical of the work that I got into, you know, I guess in the later part of my artistic career. This piece is called Sub-Ethereal Decay. And if you're familiar with these linear accelerators where they collide subatomic particles together and try and figure out what comes out of them when they decay.
Oh, okay. Yeah.
You know, you bash neutrons together and some other smaller, you know, component comes out of it.
Like your what do they call it? The collider.
Yes.
This is that big, huge 20-mile circle that they have in Switzerland. They start rotating, what is it, the particle?
Particle accelerator or whatever, and they get it all up to some incredible speed, and then they redirect and they crash them together. And they call it the decay, when what comes out of that. So this was just sort of a whimsical interpretation of that in steel, of all these different shapes coming out, exploding from the center of this thing.
That's very fascinating. I like the application of science here. It really makes a lot of sense. And the it almost has also like a dance sort of feel to it. I get like a reference to Matisse in that.
Oh, okay, know? Interesting.
In a way, you know, the way that it flows in the
I had not specifically thought of that Matisse, but it's to say that it is has a dance element to it is right on.
I'm liking it. I'm liking it very much.
So that piece is probably about 7 feet tall. And these are all kind of heavy. They're all hard to move, and I usually like to get them in one place and leave them there.
So this is a permanent installation here?
That's actually that's at a gallery right now. But it's outside, and all the steel is from like 3/8 up to 3/4 inch. All the stuff. I used to get these massive pieces of pipe and stuff from scrap yards and all. I would cut the shapes out of them.
Okay, so most of this stuff is salvaged steel.
Yeah.
Would you say? Yep. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, do you ever have them manufacture any pieces for you?
Every now and then, I'll go to a place and maybe get on a water jet table or a place where they can cut out some 1-inch steel plate. If it's a lot of cutting and I don't want to do the grinding myself, I'll let them cut it.
That's a lot of work.
But over the years, I have. Just cut miles and miles. I mean, literally, I've cut over a couple of miles worth of metal with a torch. I used to work for a guy that's all I did all day long was cut these huge, long pieces of steel so that we could weld them together into larger elements. Mm-hmm. And so most of what I do is cutting with a torch, grinding, put the metal in a vise and grind it with a body grinder, and then use the welder to weld them together.
Weld them together.
Yeah.
Oh, well, how about that? This seems to follow the same rule. Is that a moving? Is that movable up top, or is that
no?
That's fixed.
Just looks that way.
Okay. Yeah. Has this impression that it's like a propeller or a
sure. Yeah.
Yeah. Rotor.
This was right about the same time, and this is called Angels in Agony.
Angels in Agony.
In Agony.
Wow.
It's sort of tongue-in-cheek, but I rarely have an idea of what the piece is going to be called or what it might be about until after I've finished it, and then I'll sort of build up a fiction around it. So this piece, if you look at that main piece in the middle that goes from upper left to lower right, it just sort of appeared like an angel's wing to me. And then that part that you thought was spinning is just sort of this nasty kind of aggressive shape. And I just, I thought I would go a little bit dark and light on it, and I called it Angels in Agony.
Yeah, it has a...
And, who knows, I might have been in some place when I came up with that name, but...
were you having a hard time or something?
I might have been. I could well have been struggling, but for whatever reason, I've always loved this piece. And it probably has something to do with the fact that it goes, from light to dark,
Yeah, I like that. I like the reflectiveness of it too. It seems to play with the light around it.
Yes. That's most of these pieces are. When I'm finished building them, I'd sandblast them, and then maybe paint gun bluing on it or some kind of acid to get the whole surface to come to one color, and then this probably has a fairly recent coat of linseed oil on it. That's why it looks shiny.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
So just to remind people that we are live right at the moment, and 610-378-0426, I should say. Please give us a call if you have any questions. And thank you. Now on to the next one.
So right about around the year 2000, I kind of I took a sort of a break from the artwork, and I got a job as a technical graphics illustrator at this local engineering company. It was an avionics company, and it took about 9 months before I was writing software for them. So these four displays here are typical of the types of displays we were making. We were retrofitting aircraft, replacing all the electromechanical equipment, attitude directional indicators and horizontal situation indicators and altimeters and airspeed gauges, and putting all that information onto a computer screen, and then putting the computer screens in the flight deck. And this is what's in most aircraft nowadays anyway. Mm-hmm. But for about 18 years, I wrote software for this place, and just worked on dozens of different aircrafts. So I just thought I would throw this in here just to give you an idea of some of the sort of right brain, left brain stuff that I've been doing.
Well, this leads into some of this the stuff. Okay, we have a home viewer. How about that? Go ahead.
Good evening, fellas. How are you?
Good. How about yourself?
Good. Good. You're very interesting. You appear to be a good guy to go have a beer with. You got a very creative and fertile mind. Regarding where you get materials, have you ever visited one of the few remaining aluminum foundries in the area and asked about taking the slag that would overflow the forms that they use and go out onto either the concrete floor or into the foundry sand, and then harden the images that slag forms naturally is just amazing. And with a mind like yours, you would be able to see things in that slag that would really turn into a work of art.
Very, very interesting. I know what you're talking about. I've not been to any of those foundries, but I'm familiar with that, the overflow of the aluminum out of a form. That's a great idea.
Another point, and this is not a criticism, it's a question. The earlier works that you showed, like where you had hydraulics and moving parts and so on, has anyone ever thought that, well, it is artwork, but it might border maybe on gadgetry rather than a pure artwork?
Well, you could accuse me of being making gadgets, and I couldn't argue with that. I don't generally worry too much about whether you care it's art or not, but I'm just sort of interested in making things that interest me. Sometimes they seem to be more closely related to art things in general, sometimes not. But I guess the short story is I don't really think too hard about whether or not it is or not.
I would think that some of that has to do with intention.
Yeah, good.
Well,
and I'm glad you feel that way. And then my third point is, whenever you do industrial art, regardless of the artist, and it's very contemporary art, people see it as what it is right now in the 21st century, as a piece of industrial kind of art. But if we look back into antiquity at the Greeks, the Romans, the Egyptians, and we now value their industrial, and I'm going to put that in quotes, or construction works, such as the Elgin marbles, or the Trajan column, or the great lentils and columns and various capitals that supported their temples and their government buildings. But in fact, they were the lolly columns and I-beams and lentils of their day.
That's a really good point. I mean, we see them as historical artifacts, but they really were just very functional items.
Yes, and if they're taken out of their context and put into a museum in London, Paris, or Athens, or Cairo, we marvel at them as artwork.
That's so true. Yeah, that's a wonderful point.
So keep it up.
Well, thank
One
you.
Day, you'll be part of the Elgin Marbles.
That's great.
Yeah, good.
I love it.
I love it.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot. Thanks for calling.
That's great. That's actually, you know, that's a compliment to be in that same
to be in that,
in that same thought.
Yeah, yeah, really, really. So. Yeah, because I was thinking too that one of the things that he touched on was the idea of intention.
Mm-hmm.
So when you create some of these things, I mean, you're doing stuff that just interests you personally.
Mm-hmm.
But the other part of that is to come up with an idea that would work in the society as to something that's going on right now in you know,
something
in the world.
Something more topical.
Something more topical. Yeah, mm-hmm. something that fits in with the the spirit of the times.
Yes.
Yeah. So zeitgeist.
The zeitgeist.
Yeah. So
I think about that a lot, but I don't generally. I think it's my desire to do that, but it never really comes out quite that way. You know.
Right.
Sometimes, you know, sometimes my work is current,
mm-hmm.
and it may be relevant to something that's going on.
Well, it's all current. I mean, when they say about contemporary art, anything that's being made today is contemporary.
Yes.
Yeah.
You can argue that for sure.
So. So the work in these computer simulations here,
mm-hmm.
they have found their way into your artwork, because some of the work, mm-hmm. like there was in your exhibit, there was a rolling screen that had all of the quotes out of Luis Borges' book. Yeah,
the short story, "The Library of Babel."
The Library of Babel, right? So, I mean, if you were, I mean,
it's kind of hard to talk about it out of context without seeing it. I didn't include it in the slide because it's a little esoteric, but
it's hard to read too because you know if you're reading a translation of it.
Sure.
Then it's like, well, like, what does that say? And it's rolling by you really fast. So it's, you know, it has just a real unusual. I mean, who's the artist that did that before, though? I mean, there's an artist that does do that. A woman.
Jenny Holzer.
Yeah.
Was one of them.
Yeah. Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
So, and everything I do is inspired by other contemporary artists.
Mm-hmm.
I like to think that I'm doing something that maybe is relevant or maybe has some uniqueness to it, but for the most part, I've seen it all and I'm totally influenced.
I understand. I understand, because sometimes I feel too that what you're doing is, and what a lot of us are doing, me included, is to just build on the ground that they already laid.
Yes.
So Jenny Holzer is one like that, you know, and everybody quotes Picasso, but. It seems that a lot of this stuff, and they say that things are derivative. I don't really have a problem with that.
Yeah, it's almost like, what else is there?
What else is there? I mean, we're operating in the schools of.
Yes. Yes.
Yeah, and you know, nothing wrong with that.
Yeah. So I was influenced by a lot of contemporary artists.
Mm-hmm.
So Jenny Holzer might have been one of them. Robert Smithson.
Yeah.
Klaus Oldenburg.
Yeah.
You know, even Warhol, you know, just a lot of different things. So in regards of this software, I, even before I worked at this company, I was writing some software, and that piece I showed you before, the Air Dog, I eventually hooked that thing up to a computer, so it was being, I used to control it with a box with buttons on it, and I hooked it up to a computer and it would be, you know, operating on its own.
On its own, right.
So over the years, I've been going back and forth, you know, between with these electromechanical kinetic sculptures.
Right.
And sometimes actually controlling them with computers.
Well, that's a whole school in itself, is kinetics.
It is.
Yeah.
Sure.
I mean, you could really go to town with that, and that's one of the, themes of robotics too, mm-hmm. is to have robotics in general is to create an automaton that, you know, operates on its own.
Sure.
So you have an artwork that operates, you know, as independent, you know, artwork device. Yeah. You know,
and I have to be careful not to get too hung up in the you know, in the complexities of all that, because I could spend way too much time on the software and not enough time in the real world. Mm-hmm. So I like to think of it as kind of dumbed down, low tech stuff. Even when I'm using a computer, you know, there's nothing, there's no AI involved in any of my work.
Right. Oh, well, you know, that's a whole different world.
Yeah, yes.
Yeah, absolutely. So moving on to the next one here.
So this slide here is just, this is a shot I took in my studio about 10 years ago. That was just to give you an idea of three different components from three different sculptures. Mm-hmm. And I think what links these three things in my mind is that I bought all the materials at Home Depot. I'm not always welding and cutting with the torch. The cluster on the left is 12 buckets, and that's also the same geometric configuration as that earlier piece, Industrial Asteroid, but it's just done with buckets.
Yeah.
So I've returned to that shape frequently over the years and found out different ways to put it together. Mm-hmm. So then the big sphere in the on the right was created by stacking up a bunch of 6x6 timbers and very painstakingly cutting it down to a sphere. I just did it a little bit of time so I wouldn't go too far. Mm-hmm. And it's a dead-on sphere. but it was a lot of fun making it. But it's part of a much larger piece. It's in my yard now. It has some large metal pieces attached to it. And then the stuff in the foreground is elements that have gone on a couple other sculptures, and they're basically these articulated 45-degree HVAC, you know, conduit. Mm-hmm. Strapped together in a series, so I can make the spiral out of them like that.
Well, there's so many things out there that are already pre-made.
Yeah.
That you can use as art material.
Yep.
You know, and a lot of it is industrial. A lot of it is home improvement.
Sure.
You know, you can make things out of drywall and whatever. You know, mm-hmm. But this is very much like that.
And there are a lot of artists out there today that I really admire that. They go a long way in this direction, using appropriating existing materials, and just mm-hmm. you know, and making beautiful sculptures with them.
And it has it's a really big school, especially around here too. Because yeah. I mean, we have artists like Bob Hawken, and Peter John Snyder, and who else is doing this stuff? Well, a few other people, mm-hmm. but they put together these sculptures that are made of post-industrial materials, of trash, mm-hmm. of resalvaged automobile parts, you know, even some animal parts. One of my friends had an actual squirrel skeleton in one of the artworks. So you know, it's like you can find all kinds of, I mean, you know, you have your, I mean, of course, he found the skeleton in the woods. I mean, I don't think it's very ethical to use animals in your artwork if you have
to.
You just had
to throw that in there.
Yeah, I just had to throw that in there, you know, like for all my animal friends out there. But, you know, most of my friends are animals anyway. But I would say, you know.
The point is, if you're so inclined, you can make art out of anything.
True, yeah. True. That's what it is.
And I do tend towards existing manufactured, man-made components. Whether I'm cutting up a sheet of steel or I'm taking a can that I bought, you know, at Home Depot.
Well, but you manipulate all the objects that you get.
I do, yeah.
It's not like you just like slap them together and make something. It's like all of the objects that you make are manipulated.
I have dozens of pieces in my basement that I'll probably never show anybody that are literally just that. You know, I've taken objects that I like and I put them together and they're halfway there and I'm getting to something that I like, but it never quite gets there.
It's like a sketch. It's like a study.
Sketch, yeah.
Yeah, yeah, exactly. Yeah. So let's go to the next one. Now, this has a... Is that on a piece of rebar or something?
Nope, they're balanced stones. This is something I've been doing for years. This is up in Massachusetts on the Granite coastline up there. I've done dozens of these.
So this is balanced?
Oh, yeah, yeah.
Oh, my.
I've become a pretty good balancer. Mm-hmm. Sometimes they last for 15 minutes. Sometimes they'll be there the whole summer, but they're never there the next year.
Right. Oh, well, yeah, I can understand that. All it takes is a good wind.
Yeah.
You know, and it'll find a different spot for it here. So now this.
This is the ambidirectional flamethrower. This was part of an event that I staged in my yard last September. And there's too many things to try and show it all here, but this was just one sample, one of the contraptions.
Where you actually use fire in it?
It's propane, and it's actually it's multi-directional. It moves around, and
So the next piece that we're going to show is actually a video.
Oh, sure. So I guess I can set that up. There's two parts to the video. The first part is this thing I made a couple years ago, which is just this rocking machine using a pneumatic cylinder. I just started building this thing one day in the studio without any real idea where it was going to go, and then I found out that it kind of had a life of its own, and it did a couple simple tricks, and that's one of them. And then this is the other one. That's really all it does. So at any rate, 10 years later, I decided to build one 15 feet tall with a flamethrower on it. So this was out in California last November with a friend of mine, David Therian, in Los Angeles. And we worked on this thing together for a couple of weeks. It's just this crazy contraption that's driven by compressed air and has a fiery breath. There you go.
There we go. Back to that. There we go. All right. So we'll go to the next one here.
So the last series are pretty much current. These are all pieces that I'm making right now. This was within the last year. This piece is called Medusa, and it's really about this tall here, maybe 2 feet tall. It was suggested to me that I should make some smaller work for a couple of reasons. One is because they're a lot easier to move, and the other is that, well, they're easier to sell.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah. Where are you going to put a 7 foot tall piece?
I've been resisting this my whole life, and I've made about 20 of these in the last year, and it's been kind of a cathartic. I really kind of crossed the threshold with them and been having a lot of fun with them. So.
And the show down in Phoenixville right now has a couple of these on pedestals.
Yep. Yeah. There's six or seven in the Phoenixville show. This one is called long-range phase coupler, sort of a Jetsons feel, an early 50s sci-fi kind of feel to it.
It has like a sort of antenna-like feel to it.
Yeah.
So it's like taking in energy, throwing it into this cube, and then blasting it out of the top of it.
Correct. Yeah.
So it's an interesting composition, I think.
This one's called hardtop telemeter, and a telemeter is just that thing that you were talking about. It's a device that you can put in a remote location and gather some sort of information, and then relay it to another location where you can access the whatever information that you may have gathered. Like it might be on top of a mountain or something. You're taking weather readings or whatever. But a lot of these new pieces sort of are in that vein. They appear in that.
Well, the other thing about this is too is that they have a certain amount of symmetry to them.
Yeah,
it's that they seem to be evenly balanced, and they take it from multi-directional sources, and that is and that in itself is pretty cool. But this now it does seem like that it's either a receiver or a sender on top. And that has
one or the other, called a transceiver.
Okay, well, yeah, there you go. Sorry about that.
That's okay.
And let's go to the next one here. Now, this is another piece. Now, this here has actual printed material that's on this sheet.
This is something I've wanted to do for a while. I've done a lot of digital graphics over the years. I haven't showed you any of it here, but I've been wanting to print it on this adhesive back vinyl and attach it to aluminum and then attach the aluminum to a sculpture. That's what I've done here.
Okay, so what's the title of this one?
That one is called Alpha Channel.
Alpha Channel. Okay, so then it's on rollers too, so you can put it about anywhere.
Yeah, it's movable for sure.
And all of, and it's four-sided.
Yes, each panel has a completely different composition on it. So there's a lot of different images, and there's a lot of information, filled in there.
Mm-hmm.
This piece is called Deep Fake Essential, and it is a kind of a non-traditional sculpture. That green thing used to be vertical, and those panels on the right used to sort of stick out from the top of it, and I was totally unsatisfied with it, and I cut the legs off of it one day, laid it down, and put wheels on it, and then I mounted this TV monitor on it, and it displays a looping 16-minute video with a bunch of short clips of computer animation that I've created in software. So there's a lot involved in that, but it doesn't really show it in this one shot here. But if you were to go to my website, the video that's on there is available there.
Okay. Can we show his website?
Emlen.com. My last name, Emlen.
.com. Oh, that's easy. There you go. And there's the Gmail address too. So, Chaz Emlen. Okay. So, everybody, write that down and go visit the site. You can get to see all of this stuff at your own leisure.
And these pieces that we're looking at right now are currently on display in Phoenixville at the Community Arts Phoenixville.
Mm-hmm.
On Bridge Street, 207 Bridge Street, right? Just down the street from the Colonial Theater.
Yep. Yeah, I gotta say it's a nice show. Really, really, really good show. And there's some pieces that are in the show that are not seen here. And
that's correct. Yeah.
Yeah.
There's just too much to show. This is really my favorite recent piece. It's called The Pickering Conspiracy.
Uh huh.
And it's it's sort of a play on these large data towers, cell towers that you see all over the place.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of my work recently is sort of a reflection on what you see when you look up while you're driving around.
Right. Yeah. I kind of find it fascinating when you're driving and you drive by one of those big enclosed generator stations.
Mm-hmm.
It's like there is so much cool stuff that's going on, you know, inside that, you know, form and figure, light and shadow wise.
Yep.
Then to see something like this, it's like 20 foot tall and it's out there in the wilderness. Somebody put it there.
So I scaled this down. This is about maybe 8 feet tall.
This is about 8 feet.
So, yeah, it's inside, and I think there's one more shot of the gallery with several pieces in it there. So.
Oh yeah, there's the gallery.
There's one view of about half of the show that's in there right now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and that one piece on the wall is a digital.
That's right. Yeah.
Digital painting.
I'm not gonna get into that right now. It's a whole long story about how I make those things, but that will be for another day.
Okay. Because we have 1 minute left.
Okay.
And I believe that this, since this being the last slide here, let's talk about what's next for you.
Okay.
What's coming up?
I got a show down in Philadelphia at the Aubrey Arboretum, which is, interestingly enough, a place, it's the actual property where my father grew up. And it's been turned into an arboretum, and I'll have some work inside the cope house there, and then several pieces outside on the property.
Well, you gotta approach the Reading Public Museum and see if they'll put one in their arboretum.
That's a nice. It
would be.
I love the grounds at the museum. They've got a lot of really great sculpture there.
They've got great. They got great stuff there.
Yeah.
I always enjoyed those outdoor sculpture exhibits. So nice.
Yes.
Like the ones at Penn State that were started by the... Okay. We've just been given the signal that our time is up.
Okay.
So I would like to thank you for being my guest tonight. And thank you to our audience. This is... I'm Ron Schira. This is Charles Emlen. Thank you.
Thank you, Ron.
Once again, for being my guest on the show. It was a pleasure talking with you.
Yeah, my pleasure.
Thank you. Everybody have a wonderful evening.
NAP Connection originates from the Berks Community Television Studios in Reading, Pennsylvania. Please check your local listings for airtimes. For more information, please contact the New Arts Program at 610-683-6440 or visit the exhibition space at 173 West Main Street in Kutztown.
Now this
good for me.